Good morning, everyone. Welcome to IIBS IAS Academy. I am Ashok, Master's graduate from IIT Kharagpur. I have been training UPSC aspirants since the past 6 years. I am also an author. You can get my books on Amazon and Flipkart. And the topic we are going to discuss is about international relations and Indian foreign policy. So the entire Indian foreign policy we will be discussing in different parts. Okay. So the first, we have to understand what is IR, what is international relations. I'll read the slide out for you. International relations is concerned with relations across boundaries of nation states. It addresses international political economy, global governance, intercultural relations, national and ethnic identities, foreign policy analysis, development studies, environment, internal security, diplomacy, terrorism, media, social movements, and more. It is a multidisciplinary field that does not restrict students to one approach and employs a variety of methods, including discourse analysis, statistics, comparative, and historical analysis. So it seems like a very lengthy definition, but the international relations deals with how the nations communicate with each other. So how their political establishments will be able to progress further, how the association between the two states will actually grow further in the development and also can enhance the peace and also global governance. So all these aspects are multidimensional, and all these multidimensional aspects comes into the picture when we are studying international relations. So when we look at a country, so there are many aspects. So which will be influencing India, or the India will be influencing the other country. So in which way all these, both the countries can come to the common ground and work towards progress. This is what international relations deals with. Okay. So what is the importance of international relations? This is one of the points which we have to study. So can't we as a nation be independent rather than depending upon the other countries? Can't we be solely just established rather than just depending upon the other countries? No, definitely not. Right? So why the international relations is very, very much important. So the previously when we see the history, so we have seen two different wars within a very less time frame. And after the Second World War, we have established the United Nations to make sure no Third World War will actually come into place. So when you're talking about importance of international relations, the very important criteria is the peace and security. The most important thing is the peace and security. So when it comes to the India, so it is a hard-earned sovereignty because India has been colonized by the Britishers, and we had to fight for our own freedom, and we have to fight for our own independence. So when we had fought for 200 years for our own independence, so the next important task is to protect that independence. So peace and security is the most important thing when it comes to the global picture, global administration. So that has to be maintained at any cost. So to establish the peace and security, you have to communicate with the other nation. You have to know the intentions of the other nation. We have to make sure all the nations live in peace and prosperity. And the second important thing is the economy. So we all know that the resources are globally scattered. The resources are not accumulated within a particular geographical area. All the resources are not accumulated. So in India, we have a particular kind of resource. The other territory has the other kind of resources. So when it comes to the economy, so we are dealing with the scarce resources and we are trying to make money out of it. So resource scarcity is one of the other reasons why the international relations is very important. So you have to communicate with the other nation. We have to get the resources from the other nations, and we have to give the resources which are abundant in our country to the other nations. That is how the economy progress. So the next important thing is the economy and immigration. So the next one, when you talk about international relations, we talk about two powers, the hard power and the soft power. The soft power is the Indian people living abroad, right? So they influence the decisions made by that particular country towards our country, right? So we call it Indian diaspora. We call that one Indian diaspora. So when it comes to the immigrations, the foreign people are actually coming into the India for many purposes, and at the same time, the Indian people are actually migrating towards the other nations, right? So because of the immigration, so we have to protect our people. Just because they are leaving our land, that doesn't mean that they will not be under our protection. And also, because the Indians are established in different countries in the key positions, obviously that will be impacting India and also the other countries' decision-making process towards India. So that's why immigration is important thing, and also the international, and it influences the international relations. And next one, global concerns. One of the global concerns which is actually impacting India in the larger scale is the terrorism. So all the countries have accepted, or they are on the same platform when it comes to the terrorism. So, and also there is one other area where all the global countries are actually coming out of the same platform, the climate change. So all these global concerns are of utmost importance, and the global concerns are actually bringing us together to make sure all these global countries are actually coming onto the same platform because of the global concerns, and all the countries have to address these issues and they have to act in accordance with the concerns. So we have to mitigate those global concerns at any cost. So to discuss all these for us, obviously international relations is much more important. And finally, the culture. So one important thing that is actually bringing all the people together is the culture, the cultural exchange which we are having. So the Indians, which the diverse culture is actually influencing the other countries, right? Is bringing the other countries to learn about our culture, and the same way the Indians are moving to the other countries and learning their own culture. So the cultural acceptance is actually making the people come together and act towards the peace in much more elaborate way. So all these factors are very much important to study the international relations, to understand the international relations so that we can progress further. Next one, coming to the Indian foreign policy. So Indian foreign policy is of twofold, the before the independence and after the independence. And after the independence, it has become more complex. And at the same time, it is more simpler as well, because the India focuses on the peace and security. And India wants to be friends with every nation. So it is simpler in that way, but the concerns which it have in establishing that particular peace and security is more complex in a way. So before the time of independence, obviously, the British ruled the Indian territory, and the British used to establish its foreign policy. And after the independence, right? So after the independence, so after the World War II, when we talk precisely, so the world was a bipolar world. So we have the two major powers, the USA and as well as USSR. So in this bipolar world, all the countries which became independent after the World War II had an option to either support America or Russia. So in that particular crisis, the India has thought of non-alignment movement. That means India is neither be going to be the part of the USA or not going to be the part of or block of USSR. That means India is neither aligned towards the USA or USSR. So why did it go that way? So obviously India, when the British left India, so obviously India is in the adverse situations because the British left India in many problems, right? So immediately after the independence, obviously we had the migration issue. The about 10 million people migrated across the borders from the Pakistan to India, and also there was a huge massacre, and also India left, the British left India in utmost poverty and unemployment and illiteracy. So all this, and also child mortality rate. So all these issues ought to be addressed. So in that moment, if India is supporting only one nation, so obviously it will not reap the benefits of the other. So obviously it is logical neither to support both the countries and also support the country as per the natural justice. So if there is an issue, as per the natural justice, as per what is right and what is wrong, so obviously India is a sovereign country. So it has to protect its sovereignty rather than just a puppet of a supreme power. So that's how India has gone for non-alignment movement. But India did not get neither the benefits of USA or Russia, and later it has changed its policy, and we'll see how. And the next one, just a minute. So the next important point is the relevance of non-alignment movement. So this is one of the most important questions when it comes to the UPSC. So is non-alignment movement is still relevant in present day world because of the multilateral groupings? So yes, it is totally relevant because the NAM, all the third world countries have actually come together to form non-alignment movement. So as per this, so now after the collapse of the USSR, now we are living in the unipolar world. So unipolar world is much more threat to the world. So that's why all the NAM countries can actually influence the unipolar world and check the dominance of America. and its hegemony over the other countries. And also, so we have seen the North is actually much more developed than the South. So all the South countries are on the same platform as the non-alignment movement. And whatever the issues which we have between the developed countries and the non-developing countries, so they are not in synchrony. So all this, the NAM has become a common platform where all the developing countries can come together and influence the developing countries to act in accordance with the issues which can be of the greater good. And also, the NAM can provide the powerful mechanism to forge South-South cooperation. All the southern countries can actually come together in and act on the issues that it has to the new global order. And also, it can provide the important forum for the developing countries to discuss and deliberate upon the different global issues. As we have said, there are many global issues. The climate change is the global issue, and the developing countries are the countries which will be affected, and the developed countries are actually producing more amount of the carbon. So in that way, so obviously, so we need the support from the developing countries. The recently, the America has actually unilaterally withdrawn from the Kyoto Protocol, saying that China is producing more amount of the carbon, and the China is regarded as a developing country. So the America has unilaterally withdrawn. So these kind of issues can be addressed on the platform of non-alignment movement and Panjshir agreement. So when it comes to the Panjshir agreement, so this is the most important because initially the Panjshir agreement, the five principles of the peaceful coexistence were initially drafted to enunciate or to establish an agreement of the trade and intercourse between the Tibetan region of the China and India. So the Panjshir agreement we have done with the China, right? So this is an agreement to establish the peace and cooperation between the India and the China on the Tibetan issue. But later, the Panjshir has become more global, and these principles were accepted by the United Nations unanimously. Right? We have presented. So India has understood that the Panjshir agreement of the five principles of the peaceful coexistence doesn't only relate with the India. These are the five principles India wanted to establish the relationship with all the global countries. So what are these five principles of the peaceful coexistence? The first one, the mutual respect for each other's territorial integrity and the sovereignty. The first one is the respect, the most important thing. The mutual respect for each other's territorial integrity and the sovereignty. As we already established that India earned the sovereignty in the hardest way possible. So it has to protect it. So the first principle is the mutual respect towards each other's territorial integrity and the sovereignty. And next one, mutual non-aggression. So neither of the countries has to be aggressive with each other. So we can live in peace. The next one, peaceful, the mutual non-aggression. The next one, mutual non-interference. We will not be, being a sovereign country, no other country can interfere into the India's internal issues or as well as the external issues, the mostly internal issues. So the recently, when it comes to the Jammu and Kashmir, the issue has taken the globally by the Pakistan. And we have said that the amendment which was done, the Article 370, the amendment of the Article 370 or the removal of the Article 370 from the Indian Constitution is an internal issue. Amendment was actually done to the Constitution of India. So it is an internal issue. So India has its own sovereignty in amending its own constitution. So no other country can interfere into the internal issues of India. So that is mutual non-interference in each other's internal affairs. The next one, equality and cooperation for the mutual benefit. So all the countries have to have the same voice and cooperation for the mutual benefit. So as for the United Nations General Assembly, every country has given one vote, irrespective of whether it is a developing country or the developed country or below the developing country. So all the countries were given one voice, one vote. So that is equality, and there has to be cooperation for the mutual benefit of the countries. And finally, the peaceful coexistence. Ultimately, all these things will have to lead to the peaceful coexistence to prevent the other crisis. And this has been adopted by the United Nations General Assembly. All these five principles were adopted by the United Nations General Assembly in December 11, 1957. And the Panjshir Agreement was done on April 29th of 1954. Please do remember this. And tomorrow we'll be discussing the Indian foreign policy during the time of Lal Bahadur Shastri and Indira Gandhi. Okay? So see you soon. If you have any queries, please put down in the comments below. Please do like, comment, share, and subscribe. Thank you.